Hey everyone, it's Mikey Millions, and here we are at long last. You've watched the videos on covered calls, leaps, the Greeks delta and gamma, and intrinsic and extrinsic value. After all that prep, we are finally ready to explore one of my absolute favorite strategies, the poor man's covered call, or PMCC. You might also see this strategy under the more generic Wonder Bread names like leveraged covered call, or diagonal call calendar spread, or even fig leaf, which is kind of a fun one. But the name Poor Man's Covered Call seems to be the emerging favorite, and it's also the name that TastyTrade uses, so it's what I'll use in all my videos as well. If you guys have been following me for a while, you'll know that I started using the PMCC in my Robinhood 3K challenge after I YOLO'd into puts at the end of Season 1 and proceeded to get my fudge packed by J-Pow and his interns running the printers. When my account got sliced in half, I just couldn't afford regular covered calls anymore, so I had to switch it up. Using the PMCC allowed me to recover almost 200% from the bottom, and now we're back to being profitable. I've even started using the PMCC in my main account and really done well with it, and I think you guys will too. Alright, that's enough intro, let's get started. On its surface, the PMCC is actually really simple. It's quite like the traditional covered call, but instead of using 100 shares as collateral to sell calls and collect premium, we are going to use another call, often a leaps, as collateral instead. Our broker will allow us to sell covered calls even if we don't have 100 shares, as long as we have our own long call to replace it. That long call, or leaps, acts as a sort of surrogate for shares so that we can sell covered calls. Setting up a poor man's covered call is not particularly complicated. Step one is to buy an in-the-money call expiring in the distant future. Classic traders will say expiration in 3 months is about right. I personally like at least 6 months, bare minimum, so that I can sell covered calls against this leaps for a longer period of time without having to worry about expiration. We'll talk more about that in a minute. And step two is to sell a short-term call to collect premium. Anywhere from a 1 week FD to a 45-day expiration is reasonable for a PMCC. However, I do caution against trying to sell weeklies back to back to back. Thinking that's achievable is like TikTok level of trading expertise. I've tried this several times, and I've learned that you generally see more premium over the course of a month by taking the 30-day contracts rather than risking going in the money during a big green week. Give weeklies a shot if you really want to, but be aware you'll likely get more out of taking on slightly longer expirations. Back to step one, there are some competing schools of thought on how to handle this regarding the long call's ideal distance to expiration. The classic side will tell you that 90 days on the long call is a good target time. 90-day in-the-money calls are relatively cheap, so you don't need a huge account to play with some of the bigger names, and you'll be able to sell a good 5 or 6 covered calls during that time period to pull premium. The problem here is, if the stock drops 10% in the second week, you don't exactly have a ton of time for it to recover by expiration. You might be stuck taking a loss on that call, and selling out-of-the-money short calls over a couple of months may not be quite enough to compensate. The other school of thought will tell you to go straight for the leaps. Buy a call expiring in 9, 12, even 24 months away. And then you have tons of time for the underlying stock to recover from just about any dip, and you can sell covered calls until the cows come home. You can even keep the leaps naked for a while if you want. The issue here is that a 24-month leaps will be pretty darn expensive, and you're probably not going to keep a PMCC going for that long anyway, so it's not very efficient on your buying power. There are pros and cons to each school of thought, although I personally subscribe to the leaps point of view. Critics will say it's not buying power efficient, and I agree, it is less efficient since these leaps get really expensive. But in exchange for paying top dollar, you get all the time in the world to roll in-the-money short calls, you'd sell longer dated out-of-the-money options if the stock moved down, hold the leaps naked when the stock's moving up if you want to, and just generally maintain flexibility throughout the life of this play. There are a couple other ways of going about this, but once you have the mechanics right, you can finagle with this all you need to and play it exactly how you want. The most important thing is to understand the mechanics of the trade. Let's look a little further into this. A lot of people just getting into Theta Gang have probably looked at Tesla and would love to sell covered calls on it. Selling a 30-day covered call at the 30 delta would bring in something like $2,400 a month just from the premium. That's phenomenal. And just for comparison, on Snap you could pull about 450, and Norwegian Cruise Lines about 240. But to sell covered calls, you need 100 shares. On Tesla, that would cost you about $72,000. or at least that's how much it was when I started making this video a couple weeks ago. Regardless, that's going to price out a lot of people and make covered calls impossible. If you don't have 72 bands, are you too poor to sell covered calls on Tesla? Well, maybe not, if you use the poor man's covered call. To do so, we will ignore that 100 share requirement. We will buy a long-term call and use that as collateral instead. And then, our broker will allow us to sell calls to collect premium, even though we don't have 100 shares. Since the long call will be much cheaper than the 100 shares, we can get into this covered call position for a fraction of the price of the traditional covered call. That's a real benefit of the PMCC over traditional covered calls. You don't need nearly as much money, hence the poor man part of the name. But before you guys are like, yo, and buy 10 out of the money Tesla calls, and then turn around and sell a bunch of short calls for thick ass premium, slow it down a second. If you try something like that, you're gonna get chopped up. And by that, I mean literally die in real life. As you might imagine, there are some extra complications and risks when using a PMCC as opposed to a traditional covered call. The PMCC is a complicated strategy, and it is so important to set it up in a mechanically sound way. If you do, you will print. So let's do a demonstration and continue with Tesla, since I think a lot of people will be interested in that. Again, we've got two steps. Buy a long-term call to act as collateral, and sell a short-term call to collect premium. Choosing which call to buy is the most important step. To set up a PMCC in a way that gives us a high probability of success, we want to buy a call that acts similarly to 100 shares, since that's what this call is replacing. If we want a call that acts like shares, then we want an in-the-money call with a high delta and low extrinsic value expiring in the distant future. I like to get as close to the 90 delta as possible, but you can make do with 80 or even 70. If you don't know what that means, review the video on delta and gamma. And then for step two, where we actually realize most of our gains, we will sell a call to collect premium, just as though we were trading a normal covered call. Our ideal situation at expiration is that the covered call expires worthless, with the stock just below the strike price, so that we can keep the whole premium, but also see our leaps build value. To make that happen, let's sell an out-of-the-money call at a low delta expiring in 2 weeks. This out-of-the-money call won't have any intrinsic value either, so theta will decrease its value over time very quickly. I like to keep at least 50 deltas between my long and short calls. So if we bought a call with an 80 delta, let's sell a short call at a strike no lower than the 30 delta. More traditional people who still remember bear markets will tell you a 40 delta gap is ideal. But in bull markets like this, I like to sell a slightly further out of the money call and keep that 50 delta gap as a buffer. Simple enough, but why are we choosing these deltas specifically? Why not buy some out of the money calls for real cheap so that we can sell a bunch of calls even further out of the money? Think of it like this. What is the delta on 100 shares? It's 100. Now what is the maximum delta a call can reach by expiration? It is also 100. So when you sell regular covered calls, that means no matter how high the stock goes, the 100 shares you own will always completely compensate for any loss you suffer from the short call gaining value. You cannot lose money if you sell a covered call and the stock goes up, because the deltas both cap at 100. But what about when you're using a long call or leaps as collateral instead of shares? We can't find a leaps with a delta of 100, even way deep in the money. If we were to buy a leaps at the 40 delta and sell a call at the 30 delta, then if the stock moons by the short call's expiration next week, we could very easily be looking at a situation in which the short call has a delta near 100 and the leaps has only gone up to 65. This is because gamma and charm get more powerful near expiration, so deltas will increase faster around expiration time. In that situation, every further dollar the stock goes up, we are gaining about $65 on the leaps, but losing around 99 to 100 on the short call. We would be losing about $34 on this spread every time the stock ticks up another dollar. This could not happen with a regular covered call, but we got ourselves into this mess by having too low a delta on our long call, and the short call is overpowering it. So let's correct this. Instead of buying a 40 delta call, let's go way down here to the $500 strike and buy the 82 delta, pretty close to my preferred 90 delta, expiring in 10 months. I could buy this leaps for about $30,500 and own the equivalent of about 82 shares of Tesla for the next 10 months. Only about $8,000 of this is extrinsic value, so time will affect this call, but at a relatively slow rate. As of right now with just the leaps, I'll gain $82 for each $1 uptick on Tesla stock, and that will actually increase just a smidge due to this gamma pushing the delta higher with each uptick. And now, I'm going to go to the options expiring in 2 weeks and sell the $800 strike at the 30 delta to collect about $1,800 premium. I've now got a leaps at the 82 delta and a short call at the 30 delta. That gives me about 50 deltas between the long call and the short call. I'm very well protected from that blowout situation we just talked about prior. Alright, so what will happen on expiration day in 2 weeks? The profit and loss chart we all love so much is impossible to make for the PMCC because there are two different expiration dates. But let's look at an approximation of the profit and loss chart at the expiration of the first short call. Notice how it looks pretty similar to the standard covered call, but has a curved ass end. This is because as the stock drops, gamma will reduce the delta on your leaps, and you will lose money at a slower rate the further the stock drops. There's also a spike right here at the short strike instead of going flat. And like I mentioned, your profits start getting dug into, and you can sometimes even lose money if the stock goes too high, which explains this gradual drop after the stock pierces your short strike. Let's look at some possibilities at expiration, depending on where the stock lands. First, let's say Tesla goes up to 1,000. Our long call will have gained about $82 to $90 for every $1 uptick. Because remember, the delta on a leaps will increase with the stock's price. So from 726 to 1,000, we have a $274 uptick times about $85-ish equals around $23,300 in gains. But our short call is now in the money $200. And as a result, this call is now worth precisely $20,000, and we only sold it for $1,800. We lost $18,200 on this short call. After we balance the $23,300 gain on the leaps with the $18,200 loss on the short call, we made $5,100 and we can close the spread. Having that nice 82 delta on the leaps helped us keep a strong gain on the spread overall, even though the short call went very deep in the money. But you might ask, wouldn't this mean getting assigned? Yes, it does, but hold that thought. We will come back to that in the risk section later on. Next, let's say Tesla is still at 726 on expiration. On the leaps, we didn't make or lose anything due to the price change, but we lost a little bit of value due to theta. This theta here would imply about a $200 loss. Meanwhile, the short call expired worthless, so we can keep the $1,800 premium and sell a new covered call. So far, we made about $1,600 on this PMCC. This scenario here is really the ideal PMCC result. You milk the short call for a big premium, you accept some theta decay on the leaps, and you just keep reopening short calls again and again. Keep this up, and you'll make a ton of money. You just roll out your leaps once you're within a month or two of the expiration, and you can keep this cash cow fattening forever. And now, what if Tesla tanks to 600? Which, by the way, is what actually happened between when I started making this video and when I finished it. So here's a good example of how this goes down. Well, our leaps just got rocked. We were losing about $82 for each $1 drop in the beginning, but as Tesla dropped, the delta on this leaps dropped too, resulting in this curved ass. So we didn't quite lose the whole $12,600. If we look at other calls $100 in the money, we can estimate that our leaps now has a delta of about 70, and we probably have an actual loss of about 10,000-ish. Our short call, of course, expired worthless, so we get to at least keep that $1,800 premium. This makes for a loss of $8,200 so far.
On the bright side, that's better than the $9,800 loss we would have had if we went with a traditional covered call instead of a PMCC.
But that sentiment really doesn't do much to ice the wound when you have an $8,200 loss after just 2 weeks. This is a risk of the PMCC. Just as with covered calls, you can lose money, sometimes big money, if the stock drops by more than what you earn by selling covered calls.
When you wind up in this situation, you will need to fight an uphill battle and claw back that loss by selling more short calls over the life of the leaps. However, you're likely to need to sell further out of the money calls to make sure you don't get assigned if the stock rises again, which would lock in an unnecessary loss. Or, if your view of the stock has changed, just close it out right away for a loss. You are by no means dead, but you do have some fighting to do to defend your turf, and you need to do it without trading irresponsibly, like selling a short call at a strike below your leaps trying to hunt premium. Speaking of which, let's address the risks of PMCCs and how we can manage them. The first risk we just discussed. If the stock tanks, your long call will lose more value than you earn from the short call. There isn't too much you can do if Tesla tanks 14% in 2 weeks, and some of us have experienced this lately. But we can mitigate this somewhat by rolling down our short call for more premium if the trade is going against us. Also, if your leaps is long-term enough, as in a couple years, you still have lots of time to sell covered calls and wait for the stock to recover. However, those multi-year leaps will be very expensive. You can also choose a lower delta on your leaps, so you don't suffer as much total loss if the stock drops. But as we pointed out, lower deltas can lead to upside risk instead. Like we talked about prior, this will be a matter of personal choice as you weigh your risks. Please do remember that you don't need to trade $700 stocks like Tesla when you do PMCCs. If that $30,000 leaps is too much for your portfolio, you can do PMCCs on much cheaper stocks like airlines or financials. That way, if the trade goes south, you aren't locking half your portfolio into one big tech play. Although high premiums are nice, don't trade too large for your portfolio. This brings us to risk number two, risk that the stock goes too high and blows out your short call. This is related to gamma risk. Like we mentioned earlier, if the stock goes rocketing higher, then your short call's delta will increase faster than the delta on your leaps. This is because the short call will have an earlier expiration, and so gamma and charm push your delta higher more quickly. You can wind up in a position in which the short call has a higher delta than the leaps, and that would make you lose money as the stock goes higher still. This is called your PMCC getting blown out, or BTFO if it's bad enough. We can reduce the risk of getting blown out by first purchasing a leaps with a high delta. If the delta is already 90 at the start, then your upside risk is limited since the short call can't get above 100 delta. Additionally, if you sell the short call a good distance out of the money, then remember, the leaps will gain quite a bit of value before the short call has any actual intrinsic value at all. If Tesla needs to go up $150 before it even reaches your strike, then your leaps will have gained about $13,500 before the short call has any value at all on expiration. To actually lose money from the stock going up in our hypothetical spread, Tesla would have to go up about $1,400 before your PMCC goes in the red. If you think Tesla has a chance of breaking $2,100 in the next 2 weeks, buy FDs instead. However, taking on large delta gaps between your long and short call makes this act more like a leaps and less of a PMCC, since the delta will have a bigger effect than the theta. Once again, it is up to you to decide if you want that nice cushion to the upside, or if you're willing to take on the risk of getting blown out in exchange for more theta decay by selling closer to the money. In summary, you can reduce the risk of getting blown out by buying higher delta leaps and selling lower delta short calls. This risk can be effectively eliminated if you're willing to spend enough money on the leap side. And speaking of getting blown out, this leads us to risk number three, assignment, especially early assignment. If you get assigned on a normal covered call, pretty much nothing bad happens. You sell your shares at the strike and you keep all the premium. On a PMCC, things are a little bit more complicated. If you get assigned on the short call, then shit, you're on the hook to sell someone 100 shares. That's no good because you don't have 100 shares to sell, only this janky leaps. So what now? You've got some contingencies here. First, you should try to avoid assignment by either rolling or closing the spread early if assignment looks likely. Robinhood in particular will try to close the spread on expiration for you if assignment appears imminent. But if you can't get out, then you will get assigned on expiration. Don't panic, you're probably just fine. Let's go over some ways you can react to this. Reaction number one. If you have a real broker, your broker will simply assign you a short shares position and you can carry on your way. If that happens, you'll probably want to cover the short position. In fact, this happened to me with Palantir during the meme stock madness at the end of January. I got assigned early on a PMCC. My broker assigned me a 100 share short position and left my leaps alone. That's not the position that I wanted, so what did I do? Remember that if you get assigned on a short call, you don't just magically owe someone 100 shares out of nowhere. You sell them 100 shares at the strike. When I got assigned on Palantir, I sold someone 100 shares for $28 each, and my account was credited $2,800. At the time, Palantir was trading for about 32. It would cost me $3,200 to buy back the 100 shares short position. I was $400 short. However, when you get assigned on a short call, you also get to keep the whole premium you got for selling it. That allowed me to pocket the about $150 from the premium. Now I only needed another $250 to cover the short position. And of course, I still had my leaps left, which had increased dramatically in value since the stock had shot up about $8 since I opened it. Selling off the leaps for about $800 more than I bought it for more than covered the short assignment, and I pocketed the $550 difference. With a real broker, so not Robinhood, you can handle assignment this way. If your broker does not allow short positions, you're going to get margin called. I promise it's not as scary as it sounds despite the big red boxes and exclamation marks. The first thing your broker will do is use the cash that you received for selling the shares at the strike to buy back the short position. Since you got assigned, this means the stock is almost certainly above your strike, so this alone won't be enough to buy all 100 shares. Your broker will go after your leaps next and sell it to raise more money. That should be enough to cover unless you did something dumb and bought at a way too low a delta. If selling your leaps somehow doesn't raise enough, they'll start liquidating the rest of your portfolio to raise more money. And if that still isn't enough, they'll demand more money from you and yell at you every day until you deposit. You should never be in this situation unless you screwed up your setup. And lastly, I can't really think of a situation in which this would be the right move, but I suppose you could execute your long call to buy 100 shares to satisfy your short call assignment. I can't think of a situation in which you should do that, because it means throwing away all the value on the leaps. But maybe you'll find yourself in a situation one day in which you should. Just know that it is an option, although definitely not preferred. Maybe it would make sense to do that if Robinhood gets you into some weird mess that you should have never been in, like it does way too often. And one final note for you guys. If you're trying to sell a PMCC and your broker is pushing back, it's probably not recognizing the leaps as collateral and thinks you are trying to sell a naked call. Some of the more old school brokers are still struggling with this. They're just not sophisticated enough to recognize the two legs together. And since like 1% of investors even bother with this complicated strategy, the brokers have never bothered to fix it. To get around this, apply for level 4 options trading. Level 4 allows you to sell naked calls. So even if that's what your broker thinks you're doing, even though you're really trading a PMCC, they'll let the trade process. Just make sure you know what you're doing, because your broker is not going to stop you from accidentally writing naked calls anymore, which is really risky. On Robinhood, you can't trade level 4 options, but Robinhood will recognize the leaps as collateral and correctly treat the PMCC as a spread, which is level 3. Make sure you're level 3 approved, and you shouldn't have any trouble with the PMCC on Robinhood. Despite this, some people will still insist that Robinhood won't let them trade PMCCs, even though I've been doing them for months. If you're really having a hard time getting that PMCC open on Robinhood, then it's time to upgrade to Tastyworks. Robinhood doesn't think you can handle PMCCs. Alright, there's a lot going on here, and this was quite a long video. I hope it helped you understand how to use PMCCs correctly and how to manage risks. I promise, if you get this right, you'll be selling covered calls on stocks that you used to think were way out of your league, and you'll be rewarded with premiums abundant. In the next video, I'll run through some ideas I have about which stocks to trade PMCCs on for different account sizes. These will be positions that I already have open, or I'm thinking about opening and adding to my Theta farm. I hope you all enjoyed this video, and I'll see you guys next time.